All right, so to close, we have Chris from AT&T Research Labs, former Netflix Prize winner.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here.
Thank you. So I'm Chris. Hi, thanks for inviting me here. It's been a great night. I really enjoyed the all the talks. I mean, we've learned some really deep stuff, right? So we've learned about how fast we think and how we learn and how we do data science and how we hire data scientists. I mean, this is really great stuff. I've really enjoyed it. And you can think of all that stuff as the main course. What we haven't seen is data, a lot of data, right? So I'm going to give you kind of an old-fashioned talk about data and an application. And so think of this as the dessert course after the main course that you already saw. So I'm Chris. I work at AT&T out in New Jersey. I head up the data science research lab there. And we're researchers, so the people in my group, we encourage to do inventive research, invent new things, create new technologies, new methodologies. But we are headquartered in New Jersey, so you might ask why I'm talking at Data-Driven NYC. Well, it turns out that we just kind of recently moved into a floor in an old AT&T building here down in Tribeca. And this, you may have seen this if you're down there. It's down on Thomas Street, 30 Thomas Street. It's a 30-story building with no windows. It was built literally in the Cold War to house our communications equipment and withstand nuclear attack. And this is this picture I have up here on the right side. This picture I took from another rooftop in Tribeca, and you can see that it kind of blocks out all light around it, so you can view it by the absence of light, and it's kind of fascinating. So. Unplug, we are hiring data scientists of all levels, and so why would you want to work here in a building that's, you know, nuclear bomb proof, it's nuclear fallout proof, but for a little bit of hipster cred, just to point out that we're completely zombie proof, and so if the zombie apocalypse happens, you know, this is the place to work. Anyway, come talk to me afterwards if you're interested. But enough of the sales part here. What am I here to talk about? My group at AT&T, our mission is to take all of the data that AT&T generates as a company, which is a lot. People don't always think of AT&T when they think of the big data science players, but you know, I think I can put as many zeros in front of our data sets as anybody. to collect data off of cell phones and off of our broadband network that, you know, powers the internet, at least in the US. And you know, we were looking to, you know, create value for the company. So traditionally, we've done things like help run the network. Where do you put the next cell tower? How do you do churn? How do you understand your customers? That kind of stuff. But of course, there's a lot of other things that you can use your cell phone data for. And I'll let your imagination run wild. Some of them might be a little bit creepy, you know, because your cell phone is a real reflection of who you are, where you surf, where you are. And so we were sitting around thinking, well, how can we use this data for some kind of non-creepy purpose? It's not running the business, but it's maybe something that we could create, you know, some goodwill for around the company and around the world. And so we brainstormed. There's been this whole movement in the last decade towards using data to make cities more sustainable. And New York's really been a big player in that. But the idea is, how can we use information about people moving around to get them out of cars, to get cars, get there to be less traffic, to help people be more sustainable? Can we use our data to help, you know, kind of drive that that trend? And so so that's what this talk is going to be about. How did we hypothesize using AT&T's data to be a part of this smart cities revolution? And so there's a whole bunch of applications. There's a lot of cities out there that are doing things, interesting things with data to help them make their cities more efficient, or just to help people learn about what's going on in their city. Chicago is one of the first players. They have online a whole bunch of crime statistics. You can go and download the data. They have APIs to it. You can learn about what neighborhoods are good and what neighborhoods are bad and what crime is out there. Another example in Chicago which highlights the real-time nature of data is this street plow app. There's several cities that have this. You can see in real time what streets have been plowed. You know, and if you live in one of these non-black areas, you might be, you know, want to contact your local city representative to see why your streets aren't getting plowed. But it's using real-time data to help people understand and live in their cities and make their cities more livable. Boston has this thing called Street Bump where you can report potholes so that when they send out pothole crews, they can be more efficient in filling those potholes. In fact, they're hypothesizing using the accelerometer on the phone to automatically detect a pothole if it's sitting on your dashboard or on your seat, and then automatically report it. That's a little bit in the future. And then Michael Flowers gave a talk at Data Gotham last year about all the ways that New York City has done under Bloomberg, and very data-centric, and using great data science tools in order to make New York more efficient. It's a great example of looking at building violations and how that was used to prevent fatalities in building fires. So there's a lot of great stuff there. So where do we come in? Where does AT&T come into this space? So we collect a lot of data on cell phones and cell networks, as you might imagine. And we make a whole bunch of plots. And we've got some experts in data visualization. And we make plots on things like, I'm sure no one in this room has ever experienced something called a dropped call. But it does happen out there. You might not believe it. It does happen out there. We see evidence of it in the data. And you know, we plot these things, and we look for where there are pockets in our network where there may be problems with dropped calls or data issues, voice issues, et cetera. Use that to try and optimize where we might place the next tower. So we're always looking for, we collect this data off of our network from cell phones, so we know where phones are, and we know where things are happening on those phones in order to run our network. And so we want to use this data for other purposes. We're allowed to use it legally to run our network. And so if we want to use it for other purposes, I have to show you my legal slide, which says that we never have any idea of what you're talking about or who you're or what you're texting, the content of your text. All we have is a transactional record that this phone was at this location and made this particular transaction, but we don't know any of the content. We always look at the data in anonymous form. We aggregate whenever possible when the application allows it. And we try and look at data. We're not looking necessarily at data at the GPS level. So we don't know that you are in this building or in this room. We have a more granular sense that you're connected to a particular cell tower. And so we're not placing you in a building. We're placing you in an area of the city. And so this is what a cell tower looks like when it's not covered with fake pine branches. It's a big pole, and it's got a whole bunch of antennas attached to it. And so what we see when you make a text message or a phone call, what we know is which one of these antennas are you connected to? Which one of these antennas connected that transaction? So the cell tower itself has a latitude and longitude. We know which of the antennas on the cell tower you're connected to, so we have some sense of directionality from that lat long. And so that might peg you down to roughly within a square kilometer, less if you're in New York, more if you're in a suburban or rural area. And so we're going to use this information. All the stuff that I'm going to show you is data that we've collected off of the cell network based on cell tower information. So the transactions that we see when we collect information based on what cell tower, what cell antenna people are from. So we wanted to use this to study how people move around cities, but we thought New York was a little bit too daunting to start with. So we started with a suburban town in New Jersey. Who knows where the statue is located? Anybody? Anybody? Come on. Morristown, New Jersey. It's my hometown. Somebody's got to know where that is. With some revolutionary history, and it's right by where our lab was in Florham Park. And so we said, let's try and study all of the cell traffic that comes through in and around Morristown over 6 months. What can we learn from it? I was fortunate enough that one member of the town council lived right down the street from me, and so I was able to chat with her and talk to the town council. How would you use this data? They say, well, we don't know. Show us some stuff, and we'll see how we would use it. So we did some proof of concept, and we worked with their urban planner, and we worked with their town council, and I'll show you some of the things that we learned. So we looked at every one of the cell antennas in the Morristown area and looked at data off of those cell towers. So this is a plot that represents data off of one cell tower for a given Monday. And what you see here is from 6 a.m. to 6 a.m. on a Monday, above the axis what you see is the distribution of voice calls. And below the axis you see the distribution of texting. And the two different colors above and below are just inbound and outbound messages. That's not really that relevant. But here you can see a pattern, right? So you can see that towards most of the voice calls are kind of in the middle of the day, towards dinner time when people get off work. Most of the text messages are down around in the evening when people are maybe going out. And so this was one cell antenna on one day. And so then we plotted this thing for one of these plots for a whole bunch of cell antennas. Those are the rows. And the 7 days of the week, those are the columns. And we can look at this and start to see patterns and find some interesting things. In fact, we would print this out on a big, huge piece of paper and put it up on the wall. Sometimes to do really good data visualization, you need to kill some trees, unfortunately. There's very little substitute for like actually printing something out huge and putting it on the wall. People would walk by and point at things and circle things and draw it. It was really an effective way of understanding the data. So we could look at this and learn a lot from it. And I'll point out a few interesting patterns that we learned. Here's one cell antenna that had a very strange pattern on weekdays, particularly this is a plot of Tuesdays. And you can see the voice calls have a spike right there, kind of in the middle of the day, and the texting has a whole bunch of spikes in the morning. What do you think this, anyone who's seen me talk before, you can't answer, but who? What? Anyone else, what do you think this pattern might be indicative of? This was pointed at Morristown High School. So the three spikes on the bottom are texting spikes at the beginning of the day before school started, during the lunch hour, and when they get out of school. And then you see when they get out of school at 2:30, there's a huge spike in voice traffic. This is them, they have to call their parents, who are too clueless to text. And they have to get home, or they have to get to their, you know, sports practice or somewhere else. So then we see this huge spike in voice traffic. We thought that was a great story. Here's another one, different antenna on Saturday. Saturday, different antenna. We see a different pattern. Where do you think this is?
Bars.
This is pointed downtown Morristown, where the bars and restaurants are. Huge spike in text traffic, right, between, say, 10 p.m. and 1 a.m. Where are you going? Where are you parking? Where can I meet you? You know, all this texting going on. Bars close at 2 a.m. in Morristown. Here's the spike. People need to make a voice call. I got to get home. I got to call a taxi. I got to figure out, you know, what the heck I'm going to do. So we thought this was a great story, and when we showed this to the town council, what they said was, that's amazing, you know, can you tell us where these people went home to, right? Because they don't mean the actual house, they don't want to know who it is, but they want to know, like what towns are people getting from Morristown back home to? Maybe they would use that to plan to run a shuttle service, or maybe they would, you know, feed that information back into NJ Transit and figure out when to run the train service. So, you know, here's the data telling a story that can help them plan to actually do something for the benefit of the people who are drinking in Morristown and spending money. So we thought that was a nice little story. The town planners in Morristown were concerned with really one thing, and that was traffic. Morristown's got this beautiful little green in the middle of its town, very nice walkable city. But it's a one-way pattern around there. It's horrible for cars. If you live on one side of town, you have to go to the other side of town. You have to go around this green. It's really terrible. It's got traffic in most parts of the day. And so I said, how can we figure out how to stop traffic, stop people idling in the middle of our city? And so one thing they kept saying to us is, we know how many people are coming into town roughly. We put counters on the road. We know how many, you know, people live here. But we don't know where they're going from. We don't know point A to point B. You know, when people are getting up and going to work in the morning, where are they going? When people are coming into work in the morning, where are they coming from? We just don't know that stuff. So we were able to make maps like this. We could identify the devices that appeared to be people who worked in Morristown, and we could say, where did those devices seem to go home to? Right? When they are not during business hours. Where are they during business hours? Where are they not during business hours? All aggregated and anonymous. We're able to plot these aggregate maps of contour maps of where people live who seem to work in Morristown. And so the big dot there is in Morristown, so many people live and work there. But they kind of come from all over eastern New Jersey, and there's even some who come from Manhattan or even Brooklyn, surprisingly. I don't know who would commute from Brooklyn to Morristown, but the data shows that there's some people that do. This was information they just couldn't have gotten anywhere else outside of doing, you know, expensive surveys. We're able to make plots like that for various events, how does the patterns of people commuting into Morristown, how does that change in summer versus winter when there's a weather event? We had an event a couple of months ago where the manholes exploded in downtown Morristown, and so how does that affect how people change? This plot on the bottom right is our St. Patrick's Day Parade, which is a pretty big event by suburban New Jersey standards. The yellowish-green areas are where we're very overrepresented with people coming into town, and the more purplish areas are people who are underrepresented, areas that are underrepresented by people coming into town on our St. Patrick's Parade. I guess people in New York have other things to do on St. Patrick's Day than come to Morristown. But again, it was interesting information for the town council. Again, they want to know, how do people who are working in Morristown, which routes are they taking in? So we identify the 12 most popular routes that that people take into Morristown, and we were trying to learn from the data which route people were taking. This is much harder than you might think, because we don't have GPS level data. We just have cell tower data. So the data that we see is a sequence of cell tower handoffs. And it's a very noisy data set. And it's surprisingly difficult to get from a sequence of cell tower handoffs to know which route they are, especially when some of these routes overlap. So we needed a training data to do our good machine learning. And so we went out and we drove each of these 12 routes 10 times each with two phones in the car making calls and GPS running on each one, and to get our training set to understand, if you're on this route, what does the cell tower handoff sequence look like? And so we were able to build that as a training set. And we made maps like this. This is one route and colored bars to indicate when a particular cell tower, if you drove along the route, which is this black line, when did this cell tower get engaged? And you can see there's a lot of noise associated with where in the route a particular tower gets engaged. So we were trying to build a model to deal with that noise. This is the gratuitous math slide to just show you that there's some science behind here. We had to calculate a distance metric between sequences of cell tower handoffs. And that was a challenge. And we stumbled upon this thing called the Earth Mover distance. I like to show it in here because if you're doing data science and you need a good distance metric, look at the Earth Mover distance. I had never heard of it before, and it's a brilliant piece of science that's, of course, decades old. But we were able to use that to basically make these estimates of where people are coming into town. People who work in Morristown, which routes are they taking? And again, we can vary this by weekday versus weekend and seasonally. And really give them some key information that they couldn't get anywhere else. Another thing we were interested in doing was clustering users. So how can we take our data and understand the different types of users who are in Morristown? So if you look at each one of these colored blocks at the top, there's seven of them, and each one indicates a cluster. So each one of you who has a device has a very particular signature associated with that device. You use it during certain days of the week, certain hours of the day. So you can think of a 24/7 matrix that you create based on your usage. And then, 1 minute. And then you have texting and voice calls as well. And so that that signature that you have defines what type of person you are. So you might be a heavy voice user, you might be a heavy text user. And we can kind of identify the different type of cluster you are. The last slide. Is something that comes up every time I give this talk. People are like, well, you've got all this great data. Can I have it too, right? I mean, all this great data about people moving around the world, it was really valuable to put in the hands of data scientists. And we'd love to do that, but we can't because it's proprietary. It's our customers' data. We want to treat it seriously. So a project we're working on this year is to create what we call synthetic data. It's just a fancy word for simulated data. What we want to do is create a simulated data set that looks very much like the data that we have, but isn't, right? So it reflects the statistical properties of the data that we have in terms of how these synthetic people move around time and space, but it's not actually real people. So on certain margins of the statistical distributions, we can give you guarantees that it's close to reality, but we're not actually violating anyone's privacy. So we're really excited about this because then we can use this to leverage you guys, crowdsource the data, try and help you solve some of our interesting problems but not actually violate any customer's privacy. So thank you very much. I've really enjoyed being here today. I would love to talk to you guys outside afterwards over a drink, so feel free to come and chat with me then. Thank you.
Just some maybe for one, depending on how quickly you answer one or two. This one right here. Thank you, Dan.
Jordan from Insightful. Aside from selling or giving this data to public forums, where else? What other businesses do you sell this data to?
So the question is where else do we sell this data? We actually don't sell it yet at all. This last part that I talked about was really just hypothetical. I think one of the ideas is, as Matt mentioned, I have this experience with the Netflix Prize, competing in the Netflix Prize. And for me, that was a really powerful experience about crowdsourcing data to allow other people to help solve your business problems, which is exactly what Netflix did, and I thought that was brilliant. So we're trying to do something similar. We have interesting data science problems that we'd like to solve. We've got a limited resource of people inside my organization and around AT&T who can solve it. So we want to make that data available to others, not even necessarily to sell it, but to make it available to people to help solve our problems. Now, there's another part, for the services that we might provide to a town or a municipality, that we would sell as a service. But I think there's two models there. One's selling the data, and one is making it available just to help leverage the great data scientists out there.
Okay, Chris, thank you so much. That's all the time we have. And that's a wrap for tonight. Thanks to all the speakers. I thought did a fantastic job. And thanks for you guys for being a wonderful audience. As you all know, now is the time when we go drink. I'll see you guys next time. April 15 is the next one. Thank you.
Our friend indeed, come build me up, come shed your light. It makes me shine. You get the message. Don't you ever forget it. Let's laugh and cry until we die. A friend indeed. Come build me up. Come shed your light.